presets kill creativity. I know it is a strong title, maybe a little aggressive, but I strongly believe that you will be better off if you learn how to use Lightroom rather than buying a preset made by someone else that was not with you when you took that photo, that doesn't know which kind of feelings, emotions, or moods you want to communicate when you share your photos. Stick with me, follow this video, and you will know what I mean. Welcome to my channel. Here we talk about photography, and I make videos just like this one, where I share my Lightroom editing techniques. So if you didn't subscribe yet, maybe this is the right time to do so. As I mentioned before, every single photo will need different kind of adjustments. And this is why, in my opinion, presets are useless. You will immediately realize that when you apply a preset that was thought for a photo, that will never completely work as is in your own photo. And in the end, you will need to adjust the presets that you bought. So why not to understand how to create your own preset for every single photo you took? That's what I do. I never use presets. Editing is a very creative process, and I actually enjoy editing my own photos. Sometimes I like to go back to my library, check out old photos, and re-edit them, maybe with a different mood in mind. And I think it's a very interesting process. From the same photo, you can actually create very different images, depending on what you felt when you took the photo or what you feel while you're editing it. I will never get tired of saying that every photo is unique. And so is its editing. That's why every month or so, I am going to do a video where I will be editing photos in Lightroom so that you can see my workflow and also see what kind of adjustments I apply in different kind of situations. I also created this playlist so that if you missed some of the videos that I did in the past, you can actually check them out. But now, let's jump in today's photo. This photo was taken in Diamond Beach in the southeast of Iceland. These beautiful ice rocks are the result of the melting glacier that is happening in the glacier lagoon, which is maybe half a mile from this beach. I took this photo in May of 2017, and this picture was taken at about 11 p.m. As you can see, there is still a lot of light considering the time of the day. At the same time, it's a pretty dark scene. I didn't need to use an ND filter for this 1.6 seconds exposure, which I took at f8 ISO 64 with my 20mm f1.8. Okay, let's go into the editing now. First thing first, I always check whether the horizon is leveled, and I do trust, especially when I have a very clear horizon, the auto straighten horizon tool that I have right here. Done. Another thing that I like to do right away is to decide if I need to crop this image and what kind of image format size I want to use. And in this case, especially because on the very top of the image, I don't really have a lot happening, I believe that I'm going to use a 16:9 ratio. So I will crop a little bit of the sky, and I will move down the image because I want to see all these nice movement of the water. I'm also using a 16:9 because I want to use this image as the thumbnail for this video. The second thing that I like to do is to make sure that I don't have any dust on my sensor. And to do that, I will check this spot removal and I will click into the visualize spots to see if there are clear signs of dust in my sensor. Then of course, we will open the basic panel. And I want to adjust the white balance. I will pick then a neutral target, either white, gray, or black. I will go for the white because I have a very clear white right here. And this will adjust the white balance for the entire image. And as you can see, there's quite a difference. I personally think that this is a little too much, so I like to have a little more blue in my photo. So I will adjust the temperature to about 8600. Of course, this image was shot in RAW, and that's why I can change the white balance or everything else. Then on the basic panel, you can easily tap auto and see what happens. And maybe you're super happy with this, and then you just move forward. I want to say that rarely I'm super happy with the auto adjustment. So let's go back. What I like to do instead is to adjust these sliders one at a time. And the first sliders that I like to adjust in general are the whites and the blacks. Basically, I want to see the entire range of my histogram before making other adjustments. As you can see, my histogram is squeezed in a very small area. I want to expand the whites and the blacks first. And this is how I do it. Tap shift, double click on whites. Tap shift, double click on blacks. As you can see, the histogram changed quite a bit. And now I have an expanded histogram with a lot more colors, a lot more light, and a wider dynamic range. So now that I really expanded the histogram, I can understand whether the exposure of this picture is right or not. And I believe it is right. Something else I want to do is actually to decrease the highlights a little bit and bring up the shadows just a tiny bit. I will increase the contrast, increase a little bit the clarity, not by much. And the clarity basically is the contrast applied only to the midtones. I will increase the dehaze just a tad, increase the vibrance and a little bit of saturation. The vibrance, I think I went too far with the vibrance. The vibrance will increase the saturation of the colors that are less saturated in the picture, while the saturation will increase the saturation of every single color at the same time. And we can see that just with these basic adjustments from the very first panel, we have a very dramatic difference. Flat RAW image versus much nicer shot. Let's open the tone curve panel. By the way, if you want to see one panel at a time, you can tap Control while you're here and make sure that solo mode is toggle. In this way, when you open a panel, the other one will close. So if I open the tone curve panel, the basic panel will collapse. I will apply a medium contrast to this image. I'm not going to touch the hue, saturation, and luminance in this image because I'm pretty satisfied with it. but I will open the split toning panel and I might change something here, especially because this is a sunset. Although the sun is setting exactly behind me, you can still see in the sky that there is some colors, some pink, and I want to bring this up a little bit. So I can pick a color that I think will represent the best, the colors that is in these clouds, and I can increase the saturation of the highlights using that specific color. And this is really something that you need to try and experiment until you find the appropriate color and the appropriate level of saturation. With and without. This is a little too dramatic. With and without. A little less. Me here. And of course, you can apply a different color to the shadows as well. Often in the shadows, I like to set a bluish tone, and especially in a scene like this, it'll make a lot of sense. Okay, let's move to the details right now. As you know, Lightroom will apply an amount of 25 no matter what. I will decrease the radius, increase the detail to a level of 50. And then by clicking on Alt and moving the slider related to the masking, I will be able to decide where to apply this sharpening. And basically, I want to apply the sharpening to everything but the water and the sky. So whatever you see in white will be affected by the sharpening, whatever is black will be not affected by the sharpening. And now I can decide whether I need or not to add some sharpening. Level 51. Yeah, I like it. It seems nice and sharp. Let's close the detail panel, open the lens corrections. As you can see, when I import my images in Lightroom, I always make sure that remove chromatic aberration and enable profile corrections are already set. I will not touch the transform panel, but I will add a little vignetting in the effects panel. And usually -7, -8 is what I like. I do like to increase the midpoint all the way, but then I will smooth the roundness and the feather. And we can see with, without. See, it's there, but it's subtle. And with this, I am done with the general and global adjustments. Let's see the difference. Before, after. And with the slash key on your keyboard, you can toggle between the two, before and after. But if you want to see the two images, before and after, next to each other, you can just tap right here and you will have the before and after. Clicking again, you can cycle between different visualizations. Next thing I want to do is to take care of some local adjustments. And the very first one that I usually use is the graduated filter, right here. Double click on effect to reset all the sliders, and holding the shift key and dragging down the filter, this will stay parallel, and then you can adjust where you want to have it. What I like to do here is that I want to reduce the difference of brightness and luminosity that there is between the upper part of the scene and the bottom. So before touching the exposure, I actually will work with the highlights. And also I like to use the contrast a little bit, which will darken my scene. If I reduce the blacks a little bit, that will also help. And sometimes the dehaze will also decrease a little bit. How bright is the sky? Now, if I want to add a little color in the sky, rather than just adding a bunch of saturation everywhere, which will not do much, I can add a color right here. And let's see with the maybe a purple bluish color what is going to happen. As you can see, this maybe is a little too much, so I can easily decrease the amount that I want to add, but I can also apply a mask and decide which luminance of the image will be actually affected by this color adjustment. This is fine as far as concerned the upper part of the scene. Let me apply a new graduated filter for the bottom part. And here, I might just want to increase the shadows, the clarity, and the sharpness. So this is my final image. I hope you like it. Before and after. So this is all for today. I hope you enjoyed this video. I hope that sharing my workflow in Lightroom will help you to learn new tools. My recommendation is not to fall for the one-click fix-it-all preset that people will try to sell you, but just improve your own skills. You will be better off in the long term. Thanks for watching, and I will see you in the next video.